So we think it's going to happen in the next 24 hours. Look, are you expecting a Y2K situation here where we all think it's going to be a big deal, but nothing really changes? Or will this have a dramatic impact on the current landscape?
I mean, I think it's not going to be Y2K-like in the sense that this has been pretty battle-tested at this point. All of the different Ethereum testnets have gone through this upgrade. And really what we're waiting for is Ethereum mainnet, you know, sort of the big show to finally go through this upgrade as well. And we're expecting it to happen in about 7 hours. So someone might want to call Nicholas Weaver and wake him up then. But everyone's pretty excited. I'm in Berlin right now for Blockchain Week, and it's sort of the talk of the town. I think there's pretty much your general consensus that, hey, this is not only a massive upgrade for Ethereum as a network, this shift from proof of work to proof of stake, but also an incredible upgrade for Ether as an asset. There's going to be a 90% reduction in Ether emissions, so making it much less rare, but also turning it into a productive asset, as has been said before. Now, people who hold ETH can stake it to secure the network, earn a yield, earn fees, and ETH itself is being burnt as these transactions are going through, making it potentially deflationary as well. So overall, it's just a great bundle of upgrades that make Ethereum as a network, safer, more sustainable, make it a better asset, and really pave the roadmap for the rest of Ethereum scalability.
So, Tom, I want to dive into the staking question just for a second here, because I think it's a little bit misunderstood and undercovered. Do you think staking as a business becomes a risk at some point, given some of the regulatory concerns about it? And would that impact what this new model really looks like and the ability for people to stake?
Yeah, this has come up more, especially, I think, in light of the Tornado Cash OFAC sanctions that were announced a little over a month ago. So far, I think so we've seen the guidance to be that if you run a validator, if you're a miner or a validator on a network, you're not responsible for censoring the types of transactions and monitoring the types of transactions that you're processing. You're sort of a neutral entity. You're like an ISP in a way, where different ISPs are not responsible to inspect and monitor all the packets that they process. That might change in the future. I suspect it won't, but certainly it is something that we're monitoring and looking at what's coming down the regulatory pipe. But overall, I think one nice thing about this upgrade as well is it does just make this process of securing the network and validation more accessible to average people. Most people are not going to be Ethereum miners or Bitcoin miners. They're not going to spin up massive rigs in some rural area in order to secure the network. But now the people who actually own Ether can stake it and earn a little bit of yield, as well as make the network more secure.
What do you think about it relative to Bitcoin? On one hand, I want to ask you, just in terms of evaluation and usage standpoint, but also culturally. You see a lot of people splitting off, defending one chain or the other, and I'm wondering, what do you think it really does to the community, and does Ethereum become more dominant?
Certainly, proof of stake is not all roses. I think there is concern that there's this sort of rich get richer type effect, where if you own Ether, you can get more Ether. And really the only way to, earn more Ether is to buy some Ether. I think at the same time, there is concern that, hey, maybe there's going to be a vulnerability. Maybe there's going to be some sort of bug. I don't really like the fact that the economics of Ether are changing over time. What if they change in a way that's less favorable to me? And so I think some investors will still prefer Bitcoin and sort of its inertness and the fact that it doesn't change. It does what it says on the tin, and it's probably never going to change and go through a massive upgrade like Ether. But I think ultimately what we've seen is, this is a technology as well as a type of, monetary asset. And in the long run, technology that is able to iterate and upgrade will win out over technology that can't. And so I think when I talk to entrepreneurs, as an investor, most of them are excited about building on Ethereum or other smart contract platforms. And you don't meet as many who are excited about building on Bitcoin.
We've talked a lot about how this might impact Ethereum, but I wonder what you think the repercussions will be for other blockchains.
Well, a lot of other blockchains, smart contract platforms in particular, already run on some form of proof of stake. So in many ways, Ethereum is sort of, catching up to where other smart contract platforms like an Avalanche or like a Solana already exist. As it's been mentioned, this is something, Ethereum has had planned for many, many years, basically since its inception. And they've been developing it and researching it since 2018. So very exciting to finally see it live. I think if anything, there is sort of increasing pressure on proof of work blockchains and in sort of inspecting their energy usage. There was a report out, I believe this week, there's a series of reports that the White House requested around cryptocurrencies, and the one specifically this week was around energy usage and looking at ways to potentially cap or regulate the amount of energy that Bitcoin miners use within, you know, the United States. I think it's not as cut and dry as people make it out to be. Oftentimes that energy is greener mm-hmm. than your average energy mix. But at the same time, you know, now that one of the largest, you know, cryptocurrencies, blockchains, is moving to proof of stake, there might be more scrutiny around this particular aspect.
You know, Emily had such an interesting question about the Y2K moment. You know, that's, you know, there's technological questions about this, but also one around capital flows. Do you think that there really is a critical scale of people who are looking to kind of buy into the merge? Or do you think that there are a lot of people on the sidelines that are simply waiting for all the upgrades that are still ahead?
Yeah, I think some people might be willing to, you know, sit this out and, you know, wait to see if there's a bug. One of the other popular trades that people have been discussing and engaging in right now is actually buying ETH and waiting for the ETH proof of work fork, which is a community driven fork, which will undo some of the changes that Ethereum is making right now and revert it back to its sort of its current form of proof of work after the proof of stake upgrade goes live. And that proof of work fork will be airdropped to people who currently hold Ether. So in a sense, you're sort of double dipping. You're getting not only the, you know, ETH proof of stake fork, but you're also getting the this ETH proof of work fork. I don't suspect it to be particularly successful. I don't think there's a lot of excitement around engineers around it, but you never know. And that's sort of the cool component of having a permissionless financial system is anyone can try an experiment and we can see if it works. And you know, we'll sort of see what the markets, how the markets react to these different approaches.